This is part four of the a six-part series. That means you are more than halfway done right now. Congratulations. First thing I'm going to talk about is confirmation before I get started on the other stuff. Because some of you all want to know about it. So let's talk about confirmation. Confirmation takes place on March 23rd. That's our next time for confirmation. Confirmation takes place about once a year. So if you miss it, then you've got to wait a year. What is it? Confirmation is an ancient rite of the church. The best biblical like moment that has something to do with confirmation is when there are a couple times when people are baptized and then the apostles come later and lay their hands on those people and the people receive the Holy Spirit. Happens a couple times in the New Testament. That's kind of like confirmation, but you could argue with that, and I wouldn't disagree. But confirmation arose pretty early in the church for any number of reasons. What happens at confirmation is that you, first of all, you're reaffirming your baptism. You're saying, yes, the thing that happened at baptism, yeah, I agree with that. That's especially helpful for people who are baptized as infants, right? But it may be helpful for people who are not baptized as infants as well. Second, the bishop is the one who confirms you, and he prays that you receive the Holy Spirit. Now, that's we don't assume that you have not already received the Holy Spirit, right? We assume that you receive the Holy Spirit at baptism, when you're baptized in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Unless God just was only paying attention to the first two of those persons. But we also believe that in this sacramental act, you are probably also filled with the Holy Spirit in a way that you had not been before. And I do not know what that means. Okay? And I say probably because it's not a sacrament of the church, a sacramental act. It's an important one. And so I would say probably. Another thing is that you're released into ministry. The purpose of being prayed for by the bishop and filled with the Spirit in this way is to be released into your ministry, whatever that ministry is in the church. Once again, I don't assume that you're not in ministry because you haven't been confirmed. It's just this is another way of doing that. Okay, this is not the only way of doing that, just a way. One thing that some people get really excited about is that people who are confirmed are generally considered full members of the Anglican Communion. Normally in the Anglican Church worldwide, you have to be confirmed in order to be considered a member of a local congregation. Because of the missional situation in which we're in North America, our bishops have told us that we can make people members without confirming them, which we do all the time in this church. But if you want to be considered an official part of the Anglican Communion, you want to go to, you move to another city, you join the Anglican Church there, blah, 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 you're in, right? You're official. You're officially Anglican at that point. So that's what confirmation is for. Here are the requirements. These are what you've got to do. First of all, you need to sign up. I do not have a sign-up sheet tonight purposefully. I want you to consider it. And then if you want to sign up, you can always email me. And then next 2 weeks, I'll have a sign-up sheet here also. Second, you need to be there on March 23rd. Some people have asked, can I be confirmed without being there? I'm like...
You missed it.
Okay. No. Any more than you can any of the other sacramental actions. You cannot be married without being there. Can I get married but not actually be there? I got stuff to do. No, you cannot. You cannot be baptized without being there. You cannot take communion without being there. You have to be there. You have to have already been baptized in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Okay? So because you're reaffirming your baptism, if you're not baptized, it doesn't make any sense to confirm you. However, you could be baptized like the moment before, you could be baptized like that morning. You know, it doesn't matter how long you've been baptized, it's just you need to have been baptized. You need to be able to affirm the catechism. That's the piece of paper we talked about last week. It's also, there's these service books in the aisles there. It's in the back of that service book. If you cannot affirm the catechism, it doesn't make much sense for you to be confirmed because the catechism is the process by which... historically, people are led to confirmation. In other words, when I say affirm the catechism, I mean, do you believe in, can you affirm the two sacraments, baptism and communion, the morality of the Ten Commandments, the importance of saying the Lord's Prayer, and the theology of the Apostles' Creed, which I'm kind of asking you if you're a Christian. In not a full sense, not every Christian could because of the sacrament part, but in like most historical senses of that word. Okay. Is that a question? Yeah.
Yeah, does it have to be memorized?
No. When I say affirm, I don't mean you're going to have to repeat it or anything like that. I'm just saying, can you look at that and say, like, by signing the piece of paper that says I want to be confirmed, I'm assuming that you have read the catechism and you're cool with it. That's basically what I'm saying. Now that's like another, how do you say, that's like another layer. To join this church, all you have to do is affirm the Nicene Creed, which really is, are you just a Christian? Like, that's it. That's all it's asking. And then the catechism is a little bit more specific because it talks about sacraments and things like that. You need to finish this class, either here in person or you can need to watch it online. No, am I going to, you have to prove to me that you watched it or listened to it? No. Do you? If you feel like confirmation is so important that you would lie about that, fine. Whatever, kid. Okay. And then finally, I would ask you, and I can't make you because I'll be in the past, I would ask you to attend as much of Lent and Holy Week as possible. Like, I would love to see you on one of the Ash Wednesday services. I would love to see you come to church during Lent on Sundays and then Holy Week. As much as you can fit into your schedule, and I understand that it's hard to do that, but Holy Week is a big deal. Lent's a big deal in the church. I encourage you to participate in Lent. It'll be helpful to you in your spiritual life. Does that make sense? Right. Well, then let's get on with what we're really talking about tonight. I want to remind you all that we had this, the first night we talked about the compass rose. You remember that maybe? We talked about Anglicans are evangelical, Catholic, Orthodox, charismatic, contemplative, activist, conservative, and liberal, which you all were totally fine with for whatever reason. I have no idea. And then the next, in part two, we talked about Anglican history. I did like 2,000 years in those 60 minutes, or however long it actually was. So we talked about that, just reminding you what we talked about. Last week, we talked about the catechism, essentially baptism, Apostles' Creed, the Ten Commandments, the Lord's Prayer, and Communion, sort of that stuff. And then tonight we're going to talk about something else. And what we're talking about tonight is we're going to talk about architecture. And when I say architecture, what I don't mean is like Romanesque, you know, Gothic, Neo-Gothic, whatever. What I mean is architecture of time and space. Now, hence, this is funny because this is a class about the Anglican Way. Henceforth, pretty much everything I'm talking about is not specifically Anglican, okay? Because this is just part of the great tradition into which Anglicanism falls. I had a good conversation we recorded a podcast today, me and Danny Bryant did, and one of the things he said, he quoted N.T. Wright, who was talking to Stephen Colbert, and said to him, if it's true, Anglicans believe it. And that's a great way to put our essential understanding of theology. Like, I think of Anglicanism as essentially non-denominational, in the sense that we don't have a specific thing that's like, oh, that's ours, and that's no one else's. I can't think of anything that's we think that no one else thinks, or that we do that no one else does. You know, we're pretty general. And everything I'm about to say tonight is pretty general. And it's some stuff that most of the people who end up at this church, because of where we live, come out of evangelical traditions or charismatic traditions or whatever else. And so this stuff is not entirely familiar to most people. If you brought up Roman Catholic or this sort of thing, you might just stay and go to sleep during this. So, you know, Sam, you can totally not out. Whatever you want to do. So let's talk about architecture, okay? Of time and space. Well, let me talk more theoretically for a second. So where I got this notion, okay, there's an unbelievably good book by Abraham Joseph Heschel. It's called Sabbath. And he's Jewish. He's dead. It's not about Jesus. It's about Sabbath. And it's unbelievably good. There's all these Christians write books about Sabbath nowadays. A pox upon them. This is the book. Okay? And one of the things he talks about in there is the fact that when the temple goes down in, for Judaism, when the temple is gone, there's no more sacred architecture in space, right? The architecture of space is gone. For a people who's like a huge amount of their Bible is about architecture of space. Right? A huge amount of the Torah is about architecture. And so when the architecture of space is gone, the only thing you have left is the architecture of time. And so the Jews had to figure out a way to build their sacred architecture in time and not in space. Because they continually were moving around, they continually were having their villages burned, like the whole thing. So they have to have an architecture of time. Christians are very much the same way. Christians do not have an understanding of sacred place in the same way that other religions have understanding of sacred place. Okay? We don't really think that this place is somehow more, like God is more here than he is somewhere else. Now, I know some of you are disagreeing in your hearts. You're saying, oh, but at my camp, I just really feel God. You know what I mean? I totally get that. You know, God bless you. Yeah, I get it. I understand why we feel, I mean, I understand the physical connection to place. But what I'm saying is, like, we really believe that the temple of the Holy Spirit is us, the church, the people. And so the temple of the Holy Spirit is not in a building anymore. So we need an architect. So we need to figure out how to build that architecture. That architecture. So we have an architecture of space that's important, and we'll talk about it. We also have an architecture of time that's important. That's mainly what we're talking about tonight is that architecture of time. Okay. So what do I mean? I mean that we build our holy place in time. And I'm going to start with the smallest fraction of that, and I'm going to get to the largest fraction of that. Okay. And I want to start with hours. Humanity has always had an architecture of time because humanity has always lived with a sun and a moon. Okay? So most people around most of the world, around most of human history, get up because of the sun. They go to bed because of the sun. They know when it's time to work, when it's time to rest, when it's time to sleep, when it's time to eat, because of where the sun is in the sky, possibly where the moon is and what the moon is saying. So they know, like, okay, it's approaching harvest because the moon is saying this, right? Now, I don't think most of you live like that, unless you're a farmer, right? Since most of us are probably not farmers, we don't live that way. Our architecture of time is dictated to us by our phones, by our clocks, by our computers, by our television sets, right? So media, essentially, electronics, tell us how to live. They tell us how to live. And what the church says is, okay, that's fine. The world can tell you how to live. We believe that the church can also tell you how to live. And I mean that not in a church is going to tell you how to live. I mean in the sense of, like, the church offers an alternative way of understanding your time. Okay? We do that based in the sun and the moon. We do that because agricultural. We do that because of the Benedictine monasteries that helped us to develop our understanding of the sacredness of time. The Benedictine monasteries had divided their time up into seven different moments, often called hours. They're not literally hours. They're not 60-minute time periods. Okay, so when I say hour, I mean moment of the day, or time of day. I don't mean, for the purposes of this conversation, I don't mean 60 minutes. The Benedictines had 7 hours. So if you were to come with me, where I go once a year to this monastery, this Benedictine monastery that's pretty hardcore out in New Mexico, and there's 7 hours, which means that at 4 o'clock in the morning, there's the first hour. And so there's a worship service at that hour. And then at 5:45, there's a second hour. And then there's a third hour, and there's a fourth hour, and this sort of thing. And you worship at those times, because those times are saying something. Now, the church, we in the Anglican world, but also in different parts of the church, we, for the sake of the convenience of real life, took those 7 hours and cut them down to 4, which made sense to us. And we see these 4 moments of time around which we build our architecture as morning, noon, nightfall, and bedtime. Okay, morning, noon, evening, and we call compline or night. These are the times where we say, okay, this is the moment at which we recognize the sacredness of time. Like, this is the moment which we recognize the sacred. So at this time, we recognize God. Okay. And so we, by doing that, we build an architecture of time. And so we have, in the Anglican way, we have little services that could be said at morning, at noon. When we say morning, we mean essentially at awakening or breakfast time. Morning, at noon, at evening, and at compline. Now, or at nighttime, right before you go to bed. The purpose of that, like I say, is to, those are like pillars of, if you can imagine, if it's like space, these are pillars of architecture. These four things support the day. And they say, look, God is present in this day. Right? That's the purpose of those four things. Say, look, God is present, God is active, God is alive and real in the day. Now, you do not have to do those things. I mean, you know, I'm thinking about being Anglican. Okay, great. Am I saying, you better say, you know, these prayers four times a day? No, I'm not saying you have to do something. What I'm saying is the world already tells you how to live your day. Here's another way you can live your day. You can choose. You can live this way, live that way, some hybridization of the two, whatever. Here's a way that we live. I'm going to talk a little bit more about how to do that towards the end. Okay. Okay, so the days. Now, every day has a sacred architecture. Every week also has a sacred architecture. So the 24 hours of the day have architecture. The 7 days of the week have architecture. Why do they have architecture? Well, they have architecture because of creation. Because God created in 7 days. I'm not, by the way, speaking about literal or metaphorical. I do not care. Believe what you will. Okay. What I'm talking about is the story of the scripture is the seven days of creation. Right? That there are these seven epoch kind of moments, right, in which God is doing something amazing. Right? He's creating from nothing. And so the 7 days still to us speak to us of creation. We're like, okay, God created these 7 days. So what does that mean? Well, from the Jews, from our ancestors, we get this understanding of Sabbath, the idea that rest is vital, and that the seventh day is the day of rest, right? Saturday. Now, St. Paul is very clear that it's cool to call some days holy and not other days, and that calling this day more holy than that day is a little nutso, right? Like forcing that on people. So I'm not talking about legalism or kind of pharisaicalism. What I'm saying is that there's a call in Scripture to Sabbath, to taking time to rest, and that this is important. And that doing this once a week is awesome, okay? This is available to you. Sabbath is available to you. And that the traditional time for that is Saturday. That's available to you, right? I'm saying what's available, not telling you what to do. I'm saying here's something that's available to you, is rest. From the very earliest days, Christians celebrated the resurrection of Jesus on Sunday morning. Like from the very earliest days. Very early, it's called the Lord's Day, right? St. John in his Revelation says, I was in worship on the Lord's Day. He's referring to the first day of the week, Sunday. So very, very early. We worship on Sunday morning. So Sabbath keeping is normal on Saturday. Worshiping on Sunday morning is normal. Now, do we always worship on Sunday morning? No. Some people, churches, we have Sunday night services, and we have Wednesday night, whatever. But this is the time, because it's when the Lord was resurrected, that we say, okay, Sunday morning. We're going to set that time aside and say, this is when I worship. Right. Friday has also been historically important in the church. It's historically been considered a day of fasting. And the reason it's considered a day of fasting is that that's the day upon which the Lord was crucified. And so we say, okay, that's a good day to remember the suffering of Christ. That's a good day to engage in fasting. So if you are interested in fasting, let me recommend Fridays to you. You know, if you're interested in taking on a specific kind of spiritual discipline, let me recommend Friday to you as a good day to do that. Okay? Saturday night, which I'm going to talk about a little bit later, I add that on there because Saturday night is the time in which, throughout the week, from Sunday after church, after we worship, until Saturday night, you are typically the church dispersed into the world, right? But on Saturday night, we begin that transition back into being the church gathered. And so Saturday night is the time in which we recommend that folks turn their attention to what's going to happen on Sunday morning and begin to prepare themselves for that. And I'm actually going to talk about that a little bit more specifically here in a minute. Questions, comments, feelings of betrayal? I am so thorough. Okay. The years. Okay, so the day is sacred. The week is sacred. The year is sacred. Okay. Once again, the culture will tell you what time it is. The culture, the secular world, has developed its own calendar of celebration. Right? So we've got one coming up, Valentine's Day. Okay. This is the cultural feast of love. I'm not saying anything wrong with it, I'm just saying it's the cultural feast of love, right? St. Patrick's Day is next month, that's the cultural feast of drinking green beer, right? Like Halloween is the cultural feast of, you know, dressing up. Like there are cultural feasts. Christmas is the cultural feast of giving presents. There are cultural feasts. There are also Christian feasts, right? The church also has a way of telling time within the year. Our year begins 4 Sundays before Christmas with Advent. So I'm going to talk these through very briefly. If you're like, I cannot keep up with all that and it's too little information, I've got a book I'm going to give you soon. Like, don't worry about it. It's got it all written down. Okay, but so Advent. Advent is the very first season of the Christian year. It's the time of expectation. It's the time when we expect the return of Christ. That's primarily what it's about. It's also the time when we remember the expectation of the Messiah's first coming. So that's Advent. It's four Sundays long. And it begins with Revelation. It begins with like trumpet sounding. It begins at the end. It's like is it J.J. Abrams who does that all the time? I think it is. It's like J.J. Abrams' TV show. Like begins like, oh, you're right at the very end of the, and then they start over. Right? Mission Impossible 3, whatever. Okay, so Advent is like that. After Advent comes Christmas. Christmas is a season that lasts 12 days in which we supposedly are into the incarnation of Christ. Advent is a time of fasting. Christmas is a time of feasting. Here's the thing about the culture. The culture never will give you a time of fasting. Right? The secular world is not interested in fasting. And the reason the secular world is not interested in fasting is because in fasting you are not consuming. And consuming is the way the secular world works, through consumption. So if you're a time when even a day of non-consuming is offensive to the secular world. Okay? So unfortunately for the secular world, Christians and Anglicans specifically in this case have times of fasting before times of feasting. So Advent is a time of fasting. Christmas is a time of feasting. So it's a time of not consuming before time of consuming. Epiphany is the season that begins on the 13th day after Christmas. It's the day it's the time that reminds us of the coming of Christ to the Gentiles. This is the season we're in right now. Epiphany is about the light of Christ. It's about the mission of the church. So that's what we've been kind of focusing on Sunday. That's why we're doing that particular liturgy that we do here at Redeemer, that Kenyan liturgy. And during Epiphany, the reason we do that liturgy on Sunday morning, that weird kind of liturgy that you might be like, what is this? Is because it's so focused on light. Like, it's so focused on light. And it also reminds us that we're, like, the Anglicans are all over the world and not just here, thank God, right? Or else we'd be a very, very small cult. And so that's why we do that, Kenyan liturgy, Epiphany season. That's just for us. Other churches do whatever. Lent is coming up. Whee! Begins in March this year. Begins with Ash Wednesday. Lent is the 40 days during which we fast. Reminds us of Jesus' 40 days in the wilderness. Reminds us of Israelites' 40 years in the wilderness. Reminds us of, like, it's a time of kind of de-selfing a little bit, of kind of like letting go of self in order to prepare for Holy Week and Christ's resurrection. Holy Week is not a season per se, but it's kind of a season, so I put it on there as a season. It's Palm Sunday through Easter, and all kinds of craziness happens during Holy Week. That's the week we remember the suffering of Christ in his last days. Easter, obviously, is the Feast of the Resurrection. There's a sense in which every Sunday is a little Easter, but we specifically are talking about the resurrection. Not just Easter Sunday, but Easter season, which is 50 days long. Easter ends at Pentecost, which is the feast of the coming of the Holy Spirit and the birth of the church. And then after Pentecost, we enter into what we call ordinary time. Epiphany, by the way, is also ordinary time. It's just a much, much shorter ordinary time. And when I say ordinary time, what I mean is time that is marked by numbers. That's what I mean. Okay. Well, that's what the church means. So the sixth Sunday after Pentecost, the seventh Sunday after Pentecost, the eighth Sunday after Pentecost. Like, we number our Sundays in kind of this long train of numbers that goes like 25, goes about 30. I mean, it goes on and on and on. Right? But the purpose of it is about the ordinariness of the Christian life. Most of the Christian calendar is ordinary time. Like, over half of the Christian year is ordinary time. And that's pretty reasonable, because most of our lives are pretty ordinary. Right? Extraordinariness is not normal. Right? If it was, it would not be extraordinary by definition. Okay. Questions? Yes, in the back. I'm not having a class on Lent. We have special events during Lent. So beginning in Lent, we'll have Ash Wednesday services three times here. You can come to just one of them. You can come to all of them if you want, but I wouldn't recommend it. Just come to one. And then we'll have during the weeks of Lent, we'll have Wednesday night programs here, which I recommend to everybody. And there's going to be, they're all actually going to be quite similar. There's going to be one for, like, children with their parents if the parents want to go. There's going to be one for, like, youth, like teenagers. And there's going to be one for specifically for adults. But they'll all be kind of covering very, very similar themes. So, you know, enjoy that or not. Yeah?
This is silly, but...
No, it's not silly.
Does the ring that you have in the graphic correspond to the year?
Yes.
Year trying to
think about. Yeah, sorry. Yeah, it's... Imagine the year is a circle. Where this is our white season, and this is the purple seasons of, that's Lent, that's Advent, this is the ordinary time, this is the season we're in now, right, we're about here-ish. And then there's markers, which I'm actually going to get to in the next slide, kind of markers in between. Anyone else? I thought I saw another hand. No? Okay. No, it wasn't a silly question at all. There are these days that divide up the year. Red letter days is what they're sometimes called. You've heard that expression. Red letter day, it's called that because in the prayer book, the days that were specifically important were written in red. Hence red letter days. And then now Macy's has their own and whatever. But we were the ones who invented that. There are many that are important. The ones I put up here, just for grins, Christmas, we've talked about Epiphany, we've talked about Transfiguration. Transfiguration is the last Sunday in Epiphany. It'll be the last Sunday of this month, so here in a couple weeks, I guess, will be Transfiguration. Transfiguration is incredibly important. This is the day upon which Jesus ascended the mountain and, like, shone with this light and the whole thing. It's, like, theologically, actually a really central idea, the Transfiguration, and it kind of gets blown off in a lot of churches, as if it doesn't happen. It's really, really important. This year, Danny Bryan's going to preach on it, because I've been preaching on it, like, for 10 years straight, and I figure someone else needs to do it. So, let's see how Danny handles the Transfiguration. Ash Wednesday is the beginning of Lent. That's the day upon which we contemplate our own mortality, put ashes on our head, remember, are reminded that we're going to die. Awesome. Towards the end of Lent, we have Maundy Thursday, which is the foot washing, which takes place here. It's a big deal. A little underrepresented on some, for our church. I don't know why sometimes. But the foot washing, the institution of the Lord's Supper, and also the reason it's called Maundy, it's not Monday. The reason it's called Maundy Thursday is because of the Latin word mandatum, which means commandment. It's the Thursday of the commandment to love each other as I have loved you, was given on mandatum Thursday. Good Friday is a big deal. Here we have two things that go on Good Friday, two services here. It's the day upon which, obviously, Jesus died and was buried. Obviously, Easter is a big deal. Duh. Ascension is a huge, huge big deal. Huge, huge big deal, which, once again, is like Transfiguration, but even worse. It gets ignored in a lot of church, especially in churches that don't have a calendar to refer to. The theological implications of the ascension are absolutely enormous. Like resurrection and ascension, like those are two. I mean, those are. I'm not going to call them equal, but ascension is gigantic. And then Pentecost, which is obviously the coming of the Holy Spirit, which is a big deal. And then this might be specifically Anglican weird, right? We came up with, I think other churches do it now, Trinity Sunday, which is a day upon which, okay, you've had Pentecost, you've had all this whole thing. Now we're going to talk about the doctrine of the Holy Trinity. I love Trinity Sunday. I'm a huge fan. I'm serious. I love Trinity Sunday. And then All Saints is at the end, towards the end of ordinary time. You have this, like, the first half of the Christian year is, like, really about, like, Jesus, 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 right? And, like, the life of Jesus and all this kind of stuff, all these things that happen in the life of Jesus. And then the second half of the Christian year is like, okay, now what does that mean to you? 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 That's ordinary time. What does that mean in your life, right? And then we say, hey, all of us, for whom that has something to do, that means something to us, All Saints Day. So we celebrate all the saints. And then we go back in ordinary time for a couple days, and then we have Christ the King Sunday, which is the last Sunday of the Christian year. It's the Sunday where we go, and Jesus is Lord. FYI. Period. And we start over again. So, just like the day is a cycle of every day has this architecture of holy time that you can decide to engage in. Okay? It reminds you of the presence of God in that day. And every week is a cycle, because every week follows another week, which follows another week is a cycle. So the Christian year is this cycle, you know, that goes on and on and on. It reminds you again and again and again of this same story. We're saying the same thing over and over and over again because because we're telling time. We're telling you what time it is. We're building the temple. We're building this temple in time, if not in space. So we have this. That's why time is important. How would you go about actually doing what I just said? Besides coming to church on Sunday. If you would like to keep the hours, I recommend the daily office, which has two meanings. On one hand, it means praying those prayers four times a day. It also means, though, there are readings given for those times of prayer, readings from the scripture given for those times of prayer. I do not recommend necessarily that you go home and say, from now on, I'm going to pray four times a day with this book. I think you will fail. You know, in fact, I know you will fail. And that's okay. That's why I don't recommend you just go off and, like, bite it all off, like, make some big promise and everything else. But you may consider saying, hey, what would it look like to pray once a day at noon? You know, what would that look like for me? And what if that prayer looked like saying one of the psalms that the church gives for that day? And that's it. And seeing what happens, right? Like, put it on your little iCal or whatever, and, you know, a little link to the psalm. And you just do it and just see what happens. And whatever, try it out.
Those,
yeah.
Those prayers in the office, mm-hmm. Is that what's in the Book of Common Prayer?
It's in the Book of Common Prayer. It's available online. I've got some samples I'd be happy to put up on our website. You can take a look at them. They're widely available. And there are websites where you can I have friends who have websites where you can download and listen to someone read the daily office to you. You know, there's websites where you can like sit there. There are like apps for the daily office. There's like Anglicans love to like make apps and stuff. Apparently, like right. So there are websites. I find it way easier to use the websites than try to look at that stuff up in the Book of Common Prayer. Honestly, the Book of Common Prayer is compared to like the internet way harder to use. Yeah.
I was gonna say Mission St. Clair.
Yeah, Mission St. Clair is Mission St. Clair is like the old school, like the stalwart website. It's the I don't know, the Google or the Amazon of the daily office world. Mission St. Clair, St. Clair, spelled C-L-A-R-E, I think.
C-L-A-I-R-E.
Yeah, it's kind of weird. But if you Google the phrase daily office, the first thing that comes up is that website. So, boom, daily office, Google, boom, done. If you wanted to, like, keep the days, I recommend considering Sabbath. I recommend considering, is there a 24-hour period? Doesn't matter which one it is. I don't know how your life works. Is there a 24-hour period in which you cannot work? Right? That's what I'm asking. Is there a 24-hour period in which you can stop working and then start working again after the end of 24 hours? Yeah. I think if you try it, you'll find it amazingly helpful because most people just don't do that, especially with our iPhones and everything else. We typically work all the time, right? Or we'll work and then we won't work, or we'll work while we're supposed to be doing other things. And let me just suggest to you. I also suggest on Saturday night, I suggest looking up the lectionary. I suggest looking at the readings that are gonna come up on Sunday morning and reading them. Like, I think it would be, here's like a tiny thing that would be really, really helpful. If on it's on the internet, the lectionary's on the internet. Also, we publish this thing. On Sunday morning, there's the weekly collect, that piece of paper with the announcements on it. On the back of that weekly collect are the daily office readings for that entire week are written down there for you. You can follow them. And then the readings for Sunday morning are on there too for the next Sunday. If you would just take those things and read the Sunday morning readings on Saturday night and like just pray and say like, Lord, would you just open that up to me and help me understand that? Like, I think that God would like do amazing stuff in you, and you would come to church and you would, from the very first song, you'd be like, oh, this is about that reading. Oh, I see where that's connecting, you know? And you'd be like processing stuff because everything we plan is based on the readings, right? And then when I start preaching, you're like, I know where he's going because I know this reading. Yes, I've been thinking about that. See what I'm saying? I think it'd be helpful. That's all I'm saying. Try it out, you know, or not. Keeping the times, all those red letter days and everything else, I don't know how else to say this except, like, going to church on Sunday morning is actually really helpful. Like, if you want to participate in what I'm saying, like, just show up on church because you'll kind of, that's what we're doing, right? Also consider, like, if it's Lent, consider giving something up for Lent, right? If it's Easter time, consider, like, throwing a party at your house for Easter, you know? If it's Christmas, you know, consider, like I say, partying, right? Fasting in Advent, partying in Christmas and Easter. Like, that's really helpful, you know? Like, invite your neighbors over because it's Easter time. 50 days of Easter, pick a Thursday, say, hey guys, be at my house, or whatever it is you do, right? And then do that. That'd be fun. All in all, I would say that all these things I'm talking about, for some of you, you're like, oh my gosh, this is so dumb. Why are we talking about this? For some of you. Some of you are like, oh, this is really awesome. I have no idea. This is great. And everything in between. But what I want to say is that these cycles of hours, these cycles of days, these cycles of years, form you. They form the soul. Because when we talk about liturgy, liturgy happens in this room on Sunday mornings, but it also happens every day, and every week, and every year. And if people who participate in it are formed by it. You begin to expect things. You begin to feel this, I hate to tell you this, you begin to feel depressed during Lent. You're like, it's Lent. I feel sad a lot. Like, I know, right? Because it's Lent. It's weird. You get formed. Easter, you like start getting happier during Easter season. You're like, oh, I feel really light and happy. I'm like, yeah, it's Easter season. Isn't that weird? Like your body in your soul, in your mind, they begin to like form into these patterns. And all of a sudden, like, it matters where the sun is in the sky. You know, you go, oh, the sun is up, that matters to me, when it didn't matter before. Or it's, oh, it's this day, like it's ascension, that matters to me. Wow, that's really neat. You know, or it's All Saints, that matters to me. You know, things begin to matter for you differently. And I think sometimes, for me, secular holidays have very little value for me now, honestly. I go, oh, secular holiday, okay, cool, that's fun. You know, couldn't really care less though. You know, in my heart, like I'll do it, right? But in my heart, I don't really care. Maybe you won't be that person. Maybe you'll always love whatever it is, St. Patrick's Day or whatever. Which I know you're like, well, it's a church. It's not, come on. It's not a church holiday anymore. It's a Guinness holiday. which I'm cool with. I'm just saying. So anyway, I'm just saying it for you. Okay. Anything? Questions? Architecture of time. Okay, we only have a little bit more to go. I want to talk about the architecture of space now. We talked about the architecture of time for a long time. I want to talk about the architecture of space. The most important meeting place of the church is your home. The reason it's the most important is because it's the place where the church is most of the time. Right? The church spends most of its time at your house. It also spends a lot of time at work, by the way. The church spends a lot of time at your office or your school or whatever it is you do during the day. The church spends an enormous amount of time at your house. And because the church spends an enormous amount of time at your house, it really is, in that sense, the most important place for the church. And so let me encourage you to consider, if you haven't, the architecture of the space of your home. Now, what I don't mean by that is you should all go home and put steeples on your house. No, that'd be fine if that's what you want to do. I wouldn't personally do that because weirdos would come over. But but I want to say four things about the home. The first is that, like, let's take off the table, like, the official sacraments of the church for a second. I just want to say that probably the most sacramental place that you know of is the table that you eat at. The table that you eat at is a very sacramental place because it's the place where the church tends to gather more often than it gathers anywhere else. Because if your home is anything like my home, the place where the entire group that lives there gathers more often than anywhere else is the table. Okay. Now, maybe if you're big TV watchers, maybe it's the couch. It could be the couch, right? It's not really in my house. Like, it's not often that all four of us are on the couch, like, watching something, right? But we do get together and eat at the table. So maybe the couch. But I want you to consider, if you will, for just a moment, the table as a sacramental place, or as even a sacramental object. And consider what that might mean for you. Like, the table is a great place for you to do the work of the evangelist, right? It's a great place for you to invite somebody over and have a meal with them. The table is a great place for you to pray. The table is a great place for you to study scripture. The table is a great place for you to talk about the things of God. The table is a wonderful place for you to be with others. Now, that is true even if you live alone. Right? For some of you who live alone, like, the table is a place where you can invite people. Right? The table can be a place of great hospitality. And so hospitality is very, very important for the work of the church. And so let me encourage you to consider your table a sacramental place. Let me also encourage you to consider iconography. I'm not going to talk about icons right now specifically, but what I want to talk just specifically about is that if someone walks into your home, could they tell that someone who is a Christian lives there by looking around? Now, I'm not judging anyone for whatever, and I think there's some really hideous Christian art in the world, okay? But I do think that objects that are around the home that remind you of the closeness of God is a good idea. And the reason I think it's a good idea is for the same reason I think that praying in the morning and at noon and the evening is a good idea. Because there's a physical reminder, there's a time reminder, there's also a physical reminder, oh, God is present here. Right? So you know, if you were in my house, you could tell. And the reason you could tell is because there's icons in every room. And there's a reason there's an icon in every room is so that we are always reminded. Like, oh yeah, you know, God lives here too, right? Consider it, okay? The chapel. I like the concept of having a place in the home where you pray. I think you should pray everywhere. I think you should pray on the toilet. I think you should pray in the shower. I think you should pray while you're cooking. I think you should pray whenever you feel like it. And I like the idea of sacred space inside the home. Like, even if the chapel is like, that's the couch where I pray, and there's my Bible that sits there. You know what I mean? Like, I think that's a good thing. Because I believe in the body, right? And the body is, because I believe in the body, and because Christians, by the way, believe in the body, this is not my personal opinion, because the Bible is about the body, right? And because our faith is physical, it's bodily, what we do with our body matters. And so having a place for the body to connect with God reminds us of God when we're in that place. Just throw it out. I also encourage you to keep, like, I'm a big fan of technology, like, big fan, right? I think it's important to own a Bible and to read it so you can, in your hands. I think it's important. I think it's important to be able to find where things are in the scripture. I think it's important to have a Bible sitting out. I know it's crazy. This is Thomas's opinion at this point. I think it's important to have a Bible sitting out because I think it's important to be able to say to my kids, hey, let's look that up in the Bible real quick, you know? Or when someone comes over, oh, there's a Bible sitting out. What's that about? I also think it's a good idea to have a Book of Common Prayer sitting out so that you can refer to it if that's something that you use. There are other prayer books besides the Book of Common Prayer, and some of them are more helpful. Those are just some ideas. Okay? Yes.
Speaking of Book of Common Prayer, do you think, do you have any time that you said something you want to talk more about what it means and, you know, just the history of that?
Yeah, I talked about it very briefly. I don't know if I'm going to get to it very much. I have on our podcast, I have an hour-long teaching on the Book of Common Prayer, 30 minutes on the history of the Book of Common Prayer, and 30 minutes of navigating the 1979 Book of Common Prayer. So if you go to our podcast page and type in prayer book or Book of Common Prayer, you'll find like an hour of audio, at least, of here's the history of it, and here's how to navigate it. Yeah. Yes, there are. The official Book of Common Prayer of the Anglican Communion is the 1662 Book of Common Prayer. Okay? I would not run out and buy one. But if you want, fine. Go ahead. Beautiful language. It's really hard to use. But, you know. I mean, if you like to read Shakespeare, totally buy the 1662 Book of Common Prayer. If you're the kind of person who's like, oh, then don't. My favorite books of Common Prayer, are the U.S. 1979, but also the Irish 2004, I'm a big fan of, even though it's got some weirdness, some serious weirdness. Let's not get me started. It's just weird. I mean, it's done by Irish people in 2004. Just saying how weird those people are, right? So, yeah, just kidding. I'm just kidding, Irish people. those are pretty cool. And there's all kinds of other prayer books in, like, you know, whatever, that are
anyway. Jesus Calling.
Jesus Calling, I definitely am not going to recommend to you. Yeah, it's okay. It's all right. That book wouldn't bother me if it wasn't in quote, Jesus says this. And I'm like, I didn't see that anywhere in the Bible. But whatever. Okay. Let some people know. Alright. Okay. I'm gonna talk about church architecture for like 5 minutes or less. Here's the thing, and this is I've got more to say about this. I don't know if I'll get to all of it. In the Anglican way, there are four necessary objects you have to have in order to have Anglican worship, Anglican style worship. It's actually Christian worship, but, you know, Anglican style worship. Four necessary objects that we think are like, okay, this is really important. The first one is we think that there ought to be a cross, a visible cross. We think it's important to have a visible cross. And the bigger and more dominant it is, frankly, the better. Okay. Now, does it say somewhere in the Bible you've got to have a cross? And you're, no, it doesn't say anything like that in the Bible. But by long tradition, we like the cross as a symbol of our faith. Okay. We like it. It's helpful. You could argue there's lots of other symbols we could use. We could use a crown, right? We could use a lamb. There's all kinds of symbols we could use. We like the cross, and we think it's we want to have it in worship. So if you go into to worship at an Anglican place, if it doesn't have a cross, you should call the bishop, because the bishop would be upset, I hope. Okay, so a cross. Second thing that's required is there has to be a font. In other words, there has to be a place for someone to be baptized. And the reason there has to be a place for someone to be baptized is, by definition, the church is Catholic. Right? The church, capital C, is Catholic, which means not only that it's universal, but in other words, that it's everywhere, but it's open to all people, and anyone can come anytime. So the church is Catholic. The church has to always be open, like open-armed. If the church is not open-armed, then the church is not the church. And so the font is a symbol of that. At any point, you should be able to baptize anyone anywhere. Like, you need to get baptized right now? Let's do that. Okay? And the font's a reminder of that. And so the font is at the back of the room. Historically, it's at the back of the room. It's not always. We get to put it at the back of the room. And the reason it's at the back of the room is to remind us that that's the way we get in. Everyone enters the church by way of baptism. So the font's at the back of the room. Also, some people, when they go by the font and there's baptismal water in the font, some people put their hand in the font and they make the sign of the cross on themselves with the water. That reminds you as you're walking into the room that you enter the church through baptism. And then when you leave the room, some people do the same action, and that reminds you that your baptism is also your, in a sense, an ordination to ministry. It's your way of saying, you are part of us, and now you need to go out and do the ministry that was given to you at baptism. Okay, so that's why the font is at the back of the room and why it has water. The third thing that's necessary for worship in Anglican Church is called the ambo, what you might call the lectern. Okay, there's in many churches there's two of those things, and one's called the lectern and one's called the pulpit. The lectern where you read things from, and the pulpit where you preach things from. In the Anglican world, we're over the idea that you have to have two, though a lot of Anglican churches have two. One is completely fine. When there's only one, it's called an ambo. Why? Because ambo is Latin for both. Right? That's like both. That's the least cool use of a Latin word ever.
The least cool use.
The ambo. The both. So it's both. It's the pulpit and the lectern. And the reason you have to have an ambo is because in an Anglican worship, the Word of God has to be read. Right? We have to read the Word of God, and we have to preach the Word of God. Like, that's really required. Okay. So I was hanging out with a friend of mine today who has a church, and he says once a month he doesn't preach, they just do other stuff. I'm like, that's wonderful. God bless you. But the idea of having worship in which there is no preaching of the word doesn't work for us. Okay? And the reason is because the word of God has to be spoken, read, and preached in order for it to be what we're doing. Yeah?
In the middle of the service, you come here and read from the word of God here.
Yes.
Why is that?
The gospel procession? Yeah. Am I going to get to that later? No, probably not. I don't know if I will get to it later or not. The reason we have a gospel procession is that what we're saying is that if this is a symbol of heaven, let's just say, like if that's heaven and this is earth, okay, what Christ does is he comes into the midst of us. He like leaves his heavenly place, comes into the midst of us, and then we gather around him. So he's right here with us. So he's entering our space. That's what the gospel procession is meant to remind you of. To say like, oh, here comes the presence of Christ right in the midst of the people. It also does highlight the Gospels. And some people have a problem with this. Some people are like, look, all the Bible is equally whatever. I disagree. And the reason I disagree is that the Gospels are the Gospels. And they're the good news about Jesus. And I think that the good news of Jesus is actually the most important thing in the Bible. Like, call me crazy. I think it's actually the most important thing. Because I think that Jesus is, I think that the incarnation, death, resurrection, ascension of the Son of Man is the most important thing that's ever happened. It's more important than creation. Like, it's the deal, you know? So, we have a gospel procession. And other Anglicans, by the way, would disagree with me. They would be like, no, the whole thing. I'm like, fine. I'm not saying that it's bad. I'm just saying I'm okay with elevating the Gospels. You don't have to.
Does every Anglican church do that?
Have a gospel procession? No. Every Anglican church does not do that. Some read it from the ambo or the pulpit or lectern or whatever they happen to call it. And finally, you have to have a table, otherwise known as an altar. You have to have a place from which communion is celebrated. Because if you don't have a place for which communion is celebrated, you're not celebrating communion. And if you're not celebrating communion, then you're not feeding the people the body and blood of Christ, and we're not into that. So those are the four things. And the reason I point those four things out is because what they say is what's really important to us. Okay, those four pieces of furniture, they say what's important to us. They say, okay, what's important? Well, the sacrament of communion is important to us. The reading and preaching of the Word of God is important to us. So is prayer, by the way, because that's also done from the ambo, right? Prayer, confession, everything else, that's important to us. Baptism, in other words, the mission of the church, is important to us. And Jesus, symbolized by the cross, is important to us. These things are really, really valuable. And because they're so valuable, we have special pieces of furniture that are about those things. And then if you don't have those pieces of furniture, you're not, like, doing it right. You being the Anglican church world. I got to be in the leadership of this church when we started the church, I got to design the furniture in this room. And so that's why the, and now I'll say something that you'll never notice if I don't say it, is that the thing I told it is I wanted those three pieces, the cross separately, but the font, the ambo, on the table, I wanted them to be the same design. I wanted them to look the same. So they all have the same design. And I wanted them to have kind of as much as possible kind of an equal weight, like the proportions to be, not to be weird, because a table the size of an ambo would be completely bizarre. But I wanted them to have the same kind of feel, so that you did not see one of them as, like, dramatically more important than the others. That's why there's not, like, a giant altar of stone and then, like, a little lectern. You know what I mean? Because I was like, okay, let's make these four things, or these three things, have some equal weight. And then the cross, obviously, is just gigantic over all of them. But that was actually something we had to work for pretty hard to get a nice big cross in. That's another thing. So, those four things. Questions about those four? None questions. Awesome.
I mean, it's
the... heck! I was about to end this, yes.
Sorry, the circle behind the cross.
Oh, that's a Celtic cross. And so the circle behind the cross represents immortality, the circle of immortality. In other words, never stops, right? It might also be the communion wafer. It might also be the sun rising, like on the third day after Jesus is raised. It might also be the circle of time that we've been talking about, the architecture of time we've been referring to. It might be any of those things. But that particular design is what the Celts particularly like to use behind their crosses. So you'll see those, or something like that, all over Celtic lands. Yes. Which?
So you see the part that goes across, like the part that's...
Yes,
right.
The vertical, uh-huh. Or the horizontal.
Yeah, the horizontal. Are you looking at, you can see the line in the middle.
Oh, you mean in the actual cross that's up there?
That's the grain of the wood.
I think that's just the grain of the wood.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, that's just the grain of the wood. So, But you can ask Mark. Ask Mark Nicholas. He's the guy who made it, and maybe he has some like. I love that. I've never seen that, and now I'll never not see it. Thank you so much. No, that's actually really nice. But no, it's a happy accident of the Holy Spirit. I don't know. Okay. So anyway, consider confirmation, and we'll have signups next week. And I'll be around if there's any other questions you have. God bless you. Thank you very much for coming. Good night.